purpose of that intro sequence was to show you a bunch of different types of transitions, but how I'm using the same set of techniques to kind of smooth them out and make them flow a bit better. Now, I want to start out by talking about the thing that I think is absolutely the most important for having transitions that flow well, and that is shooting for the edit. And I know you're probably rolling your eyes right now, like, Aidin, shut up about cameras, I want to talk about transitions. But the quality of your editing depends entirely on the quality of your footage. So it's important to know how to capture your footage right so that you can edit it well. When you're out filming, you want to always be looking for transition opportunities. So for example, when I was filming the edit that you just saw, I had a clip of this car and this sign, and I also had a clip of this church. And then I saw an opportunity when I was waiting on the bus, actually, to get a clip that went from the church to the car and use that to transition between the other two clips and kind of bridge them together. In addition to looking for transitions themselves, it's important to think about your camera settings and how you need to shoot in order to pull the transition off. So if you want to do some motion tracking, you might want to shoot with a slightly higher shutter speed. Or if you're doing a whip pan, you might want to shoot with a lower shutter speed so that there's more motion blur and it masks that transition. So the way you shoot is immensely important. But now that we've talked about that, we can jump into the editing itself, starting out with keyframe interpolation. This is a term that you've probably heard before, and it basically just means smoothing out the start and stop of your animations in such a way that it makes the entire transition just flow a lot more smoothly and realistically and helps to hide the imperfections within it. If you're in After Effects, start out by selecting the animation that you want to adjust, then open the graph editor. Then just select all of the keyframes that you want to affect and click this button at the bottom of the screen. I've got no idea what it's called, but it makes the animations have these little handles on them that you can use to adjust how exponential and gradual they are. At this point, it's more or less self-explanatory. Just move those handles around so that you have an animation that's faster in the middle than it is at the beginning and end. For some properties like position or mask path, the value graph doesn't always work for smoothing out those animations, but what you can use instead is the speed graph. And even though I'm showing how to do this in After Effects, there's similar features in Premiere that you can use to make those animations more gradual. Another technique that I'll usually use to add some more intensity to my animations is add some digital camera shake. To do this in After Effects, start out by pre-composing all of your clips, then alt-click the position keyframe. Once you've done that, type wiggle, then an open bracket, and then the frequency of the shake. So how many times every second you want the camera to move. Then just type a comma followed by the shake amount. This can be any number because we're going to come back to it in a second. And finally, a closed bracket, and click out of the box and you should see that you've added some randomized digital camera shake to your footage. Even if this effect looks good, it's constant. So it's happening over the entire duration of the clip at a constant intensity. And what I want it to do is start out with no shake and then build up as the transition happens, then fade away again. To animate the amount of camera shake, just create a new adjustment layer over your footage and drag an effect called slider control onto that adjustment layer. Then go back to that expression that we typed in and delete the second value. And then while your cursor is still in the place where that number would be, drag the pick whip next to the position property to the slider control effect. It's a bit of a process, but just try it out a few times and you should get the hang of it. If you do all of that correctly, you'll be able to animate the value for that slider control effect to control the amount of shake on your clip. Pretty nifty effect if you ask me, and yes, this is the most complicated thing that I know how to do in After Effects. When you're working with any kind of movement or animation, it's extremely important to add motion blur to the effect. This helps to make the entire thing look more realistic, and it also really helps to mask the imperfections and seams behind the transition. If your entire transition is just keyframe animations like position and scale, you can simply check off the box next to your clip to enable motion blur and then enable motion blur for the composition and you'll have it automatically. In addition, most editing software has some kind of effect or tool that you can use to analyze the clip and add in some automatic motion blur that way. And finally, you can also try out using a directional blur, a zoom blur, or a radial blur to add fake motion blur. Basically, just put the effect on an adjustment layer and keyframe it to go over the motion and you should have a pretty good effect that way. The one thing that's a constant between all transitions is that they consist of two clips back to back, and that's why it's incredibly important for a smooth transition to mask the colors and lighting of your clips. With any two clips, there's gonna be some inconsistencies between the camera settings, the lighting conditions, the colors that are present in front of the camera, and that's why it's important to match the grade as closely as you can. So I'm basically just gonna use a value curve as well as the hue and saturation curves in Lumetri Color to match the two clips as closely as I can. All the techniques I've talked about here are visual, but sound is also incredibly important for any kind of transition. Any kind of transition. I get my sound effects from a site called Epidemic Sound, which is a great library of music and sound effects for your videos. There's a ton of different options and variations for what you can download. So if you want to try it out for yourself, there'll be an affiliate link in the description where you can try out a free 30-day trial. I've also got like four other tutorials that are all about sound design. So if you want to check those out, there'll be a playlist right up there. And there's actually one that's entirely about transition sound effects. As for the sequence that I've been using as an example here, I'm gonna start out by adding in some city ambience in the background to just show the viewer what kind of environment we're in right off the bat. Then I also want to accentuate the church, so I'm gonna add in the sound of some church bells, and I also want to bring out the car, so I'm gonna add in the sound of that car passing in front of the camera. And last but not least, I'm gonna add in the sound of that transition itself, and I'm just gonna use a big whoosh sound effect because it's a relatively fast zoom transition. All the techniques I've talked about in this video will help you to improve your transitions, but there's really no point in doing that if the transition doesn't make any sense in the first place. If you zoom in to a wider shot, stuff like that just doesn't make sense. And that's why it's important to not just slap a random preset transition on your clips because the transition itself looks cool. It's even more important to think about the clips themselves and why you're transitioning between them. Because no matter how smooth and seamless it may be, a transition without any direction behind it is just gonna take your viewer out of the video. That being said, I hope that you've picked up some new techniques from watching this video. And if you did, do feel free to share your support by leaving a like on the video, sharing it with your friends, or even subscribing to my channel. I upload two new filmmaking tutorials every single week. But that's all for now. Keep creating, and I'll see you in the next one.